morning, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls. Boys and girls, we often gather in this room for different kinds of occasions. Today is a very special memorial occasion that we gather. Several weeks ago, we all heard about the very sudden and tragic passing of one of the great leaders of our community, of the Jewish people, indeed a great humanitarian, Mr. Edmund Safra. And I'm sure you know, boys and girls, you watched the TV news and read the newspapers, it's a great deal of discussion. There's a great deal of discussion about the tragic events surrounding his death. We're not here today to discuss those issues. It's a sad and tragic fact that this great humanitarian was taken from us so suddenly and so swiftly and so tragically. What we're here today is to discuss now not how he died, but indeed how he lived. What were the guideposts of his life? What were the principles he lived by? What were the things he wanted to have accomplished? And above all, I think, what lessons are there to learn from his life that we can apply to our own? You're going to hear from a variety of people this morning who will give you their personal memories of the many years of their friendship and association with Mr. Safra. You're going to see a brief video about his life. And we will conclude with the Tehillim that you found on your chair. Please hold them quietly. And the Hashkava al-Kaddish, and finally, the singing of HaTikva. What I will ask you to do is to sit back, sit up straight, listen carefully. Normally, I know you're very polite, and when somebody speaks to you, you applaud. But today's a memorial assembly, and applause are probably not appropriate, not proper today. So just sit, listen carefully, and see by the end if we can piece together in your own minds some lessons, some ideas, some of the things that we can learn for our own lives, and some appreciation of the accomplishments and achievements of Mr. Safra that will live on for hundreds of years and many, many generations to come in the United States, in Israel, and indeed throughout the world. It's my pleasure and privilege to introduce to you a gentleman who will introduce most of the rest of the program, one of the officers of our yeshiva, parent in our yeshiva, and a person who in his personal life exemplifies the finest of midot tovot. My pleasure to introduce Mr. Joey Harari. Joey?
Thank you, Rabbi. During his lifetime, Mr. Safra managed to forge relationships with various individuals throughout the world. I would like to share with you a letter that we received from the Prime Minister of Israel. It is with great sorrow that we mourn the loss of Edmund Safra, an exemplary human being, a great philanthropist, and an ingenious businessman. On behalf of the government of Israel, I extend my sincere condolences to his wonderful family during this very difficult time. May they find a source of comfort in the knowledge that Edmund Safra led a rich and extraordinary life. He will be remembered by all of us for his kindness, compassion, and chesed. Sincerely, Ehud Barak, Prime Minister of the State of Israel. And now I'd like to introduce a very close personal friend and associate of Mr. Safra, Alav HaShalom, Mr. Miro Sutton.
Rabbi, members of the committee, ladies and gentlemen, boys, girls. I was asked to speak to you about Mr. Edmond Safra, alayhi as-salam. I guess your school has chosen me because I had the privilege to be very close to him and his family since my early childhood. Mr. Safra was born in Lebanon, and his family lived less than a block away from my house in Beirut. As a child and a teenager, he was a very active person. And I remember my father, alayhi as-salam, always saying about him, "Mashallah, this kid is a phenomenon, and no doubt he will go very far in life." I could stand here for hours and talk about Edmond, alayhi as-salam. But I will try to describe to you as briefly as possible who he was, what he was, and what you and I should learn from him and his life. Mr. Safra was an extremely intelligent individual, well above any man I encountered in my whole life. I worked for him close to 17 years at the Republic National Bank of New York, and many a time, before I or any other associate starting presenting an idea, he would have caught it and knew exactly where we wanted to go. Because of this sixth sense, if I may call it, he built what has been described a financial empire stretching over the five continents of the planet. With all that, he was a most gentle person, humble to the extreme. If I dare paraphrase the Torah, I would say, "Ve'ish Edmon anav mikol adam." He would remember everybody and give everyone the same respect, be it the chairman of a major corporation or the doorman of a hotel. Above everything, he felt a limitless pride of being Jewish, Sephardi, and certainly of Syrian-Lebanese origin. There is not a Jewish community anywhere that did not benefit from his generosity. There is not an old synagogue or other Jewish landmark that needed repair that he did not attend to. Thanks to his generosity, one of our most revered shrines, the tomb of Rabbi Meir Ba'al HaNes in Tveria, is now a beautiful mausoleum after having been in such a decay that it was an eyesore. The community in Brazil, and especially São Paulo, came back to life because of Edmond and his brothers Moise and Joseph. They subsidized kashrut, yeshivot, synagogues, and youth centers. Now we come back to New York. This very school has benefited from Mr. Safra's generosity since day one, as did every school and yeshiva in our community, both in Brooklyn and on the Jersey Shore. Our center, of which we are all so proud, received its biggest impetus from Mr. Safra on the day he dedicated two Sifrei Torah to Sha'arei Tzion, which itself would not be this jewel of ours without his generosity. All you have to do is take a walk around our neighborhoods, and you will see the Safra name everywhere. Yeshivot, shuls, mikveot, etc. However, one of his most noble acts was to give job and security to any Lebanese who had to flee from the civil war and leave everything behind. Whether they spoke English or not, whether they were qualified or not, his directive to us was, you give them a job. And let me tell you, for many of those, that job was the stepping stone to careers in retail, wholesale, etc. And today, I know a good few who became not only self-supporting, but enjoying the American dream, as we call it. Talking about the war in Lebanon, he worked very closely with Alav Shalom, Rav Shahut Shrein, in order to evacuate all the Sifrei Torah and other holy items, which was done at the cost of untold millions and with the minimum of damage. Now I want to conclude with something that should touch each and every one of you, girls and boys. As I told before, Mr. Safra was very precocious and could not wait to join his father's band. He therefore did not finish high school. But believe me, he confided in me so many times about how much he regretted that. He encouraged his younger brothers, Moise and Joseph, to get that formal education, which they did in Brighton, England, at a Jewish college there. He was really obsessed with higher education. And finally, in 1977, he established ISEF, the International Sephardi Education Foundation, of which I was the first treasurer. Mr. Sonny Gindi and Mrs. Nina Wiener were its first chairman and president. What Mr. Safra had in mind was primarily to provide college education to Sephardim in Israel, where he felt that they were lagging behind because of the lack of financial means. Today, 22 years later, close to 10,000 Sephardim in Israel have benefited from this scholarship. They graduated and are becoming leaders in their country. Before I conclude, I want to repeat one thing I said yesterday in Shaare Tzion. We consider this family, the Safra, as our own royalty. Nations around the world have their House of Windsor in England or the House of Orange Nassau in the Netherlands. They look up to, they try to emulate. We have the House of Safra. We should be proud of this house. And the torch has been picked up. Edmon Alav Shalom was our crown. It fell, but we have two crowns to continue. It's Moise and Joseph, God bless them. In conclusion, I think that what we could learn from Mr. Safra's life is to be a proud Jew, an observant Jew, a generous Jew, without neglecting to be an educated Jew. Thank you.
Thank you, Miro. The video you're about to see was made during Mr. Safra's lifetime. We are presenting it to you today so that you can get a sense of what kind of individual he was. Besides being a legend, he was a warm, loving family man.
Fifty years ago, Edmund Safra set out on a journey to fulfill the prophecy of his father, to become a great banker. If you choose to sail upon the seas of banking, build your bank as you would your boat, with the strength to sail safely through any storm. These words, his family's commitment to the intense values of respect, prudence, conservatism, trust, loyalty, and charity instilled in him by his parents, have guided him through the years. Born in Beirut in 1932, Edmund Safra, the son of Esther and Jacob, who proclaimed early in his son's life that he would be a great banker. He began his education at his father's knee, preferring this way of learning to attending school, even after his father hired a valet to be certain his son arrived at school every day. His father's prophecy was fulfilled when at the age of 16, he left for Milan to begin his career. It wasn't long before Edmund's reputation was established as a prodigious precious metals and currency trader in Milan, Zurich, Amsterdam, and Geneva. Edmund's reputation earned no doubt by being always hard at work. By all accounts, his father Jacob was bursting with pride back in Beirut. In the early 1950s, believing that there were real opportunities to succeed in banking in Brazil, Edmund soon convinced his family to follow him there. By the mid-1950s, he and his family had built a successful trading, import, and finance company that ultimately became Banco Safra S.A., today the fifth largest bank in Brazil. Many long and arduous meetings involving difficult negotiations, all contributing to Edmund's formation as an experienced banker. In 1956, he left Brazil for Geneva, drawn by the challenge of building a Swiss private bank. During the many successful years he spent in Geneva, he founded his first fully chartered bank, the Trade Development Bank, and began to establish his reputation as one of the world's great private bankers. He followed his success in Geneva by pursuing his ambition to create a bank in the most important financial center in the world, New York City. Edmund formally opened Republic National Bank of New York on January 25, 1966. He engineered the tremendous growth of his banks over the ensuing years through innovative marketing, acquisitions, expanding into new geographical areas and lines of business. During these years of growth, Edmund and his family continuously adhered to his father's principles of prudence, trust, and of course, conservatism. Edmund has often been quoted as saying, "I am in no hurry to build my bank. I want to build a bank to last 1,000 years. The quality of his banks have been recognized around the world, and as confirmation of the banking community's belief in Edmund's objective of building a lasting bank, Safra Republic Holdings issued the first ever 1,000-year bond in October of 1997. Edmund Safra's commitment to charity is as serious as his commitment to banking. It's an obligation he feels he must fulfill, rooted in his childhood observation of his mother's distribution of food to those in need, sending the most needy to his father for money. He firmly believes that charity is an investment in people and the future. He founded the International Sephardic Education Foundation to help educate disadvantaged young Israelis. To date, the foundation has provided more than 10,000 university and postgraduate scholarships. Edmund has supported numerous synagogues, community centers, and other religious, cultural, medical, and educational institutions all around the world, always in honor and memory of his father and mother. His devotion to his father and mother is reflected today in his devotion to his family.
I am Joseph Safra, Edmund Safra, youngest brother. Effectively, I was brought up by you, Edmund. Since I left school, I was under your guidance, and practically every day you taught me another lesson. And whatever I achieved in my life, and whatever I am today, is only thanks to you. It's a very unique relationship between two brothers. And let me tell you, Edmond, that while you were watching me, I was also watching you, but for different reasons. You wanted to make sure that I was doing well while I was watching you to copy you. You are for me my father, my dear brother, my teacher, and for that I have no word to show my gratitude to you. I want to thank you deep in my heart, and God bless you, and a big kiss to you.
I am Moise Safra, and I am the brother of Edmund. When he was a young child, he was always very happy and jovial. He had many friends, and they would laugh together a lot. Many of his friends were older than he was. When he came back home, the house was much happier than when he was gone. We all laughed much more. My father was very proud about what he has done, and he spoke often about Edmund's success. Edmund was so successful that some of his competitors would spread it around that he was only 16 years old and that because of his age, his commitments were not binding. This unfair competition did not stop him. Edmund, you are like a father to us, and we love you very much.
Edmund, congratulations on your 50th anniversary in the banking business from your 6,000 employees who have helped in their own ways to build this organization with you into the magnificent institution it is.
To my husband, who has given me so much, his devotion to our grandchildren, his presence at all times, not only for me and them, but for so many others, a father to his brothers and sisters, a loyal friend to so many throughout the world. Together, we've tried to keep our heads high, to fight for life and hope, to fight the battles in the name of justice. May our almost seven grandchildren achieve in their lives the values and ideals that you have taught them. You fulfill the essence of a human being. You are kind, decent, a man with no vanity, a humble man. Thank you, Edmund, for sharing these years with me.
Mr. Edmund Safra's brothers, Moyiz and Joseph Safra, thank you for coming. And now, I'd like to introduce a very close friend of Mr. Safra, Alav HaShalom, Mr. Joe Carey. Good morning. I'm happy to be at this school. I remember when we did the groundbreaking ceremony for Mag and David, and Edmund and Rabbi Kasson and all of us were so happy to get this school started. You've all heard so many things about what a great man Edmund Safra was. And he was a great man. He was an angel. There were some special qualities he had that we as Sephardim should try to emulate. And let me repeat some of the things that we said yesterday about him and what we as a community should learn from him. Be humble. Be caring. Help your fellow community members in their time of need. Give jobs to those who need them, not just a handout. As Miro said before me, anybody who came here from Lebanon or whatever country that needed help, he didn't just give them money to eat, he gave them a job so that they could provide for themselves. Give tzedakah. He always worried about people, and he gave tzedakah in every place that he could. Respect our rabbis. Every rabbi in the world came up to him, and he was as nice and as humble as he could be. And he helped them in many, many ways. Help educate our youth. Boy, would he be proud if he was here this morning. He loved children, and he loved our youth. In fact, one of the last things he did with me was say that it's our obligation to give a Jewish education to every Jewish child in this world. And everybody will talk about the great businessman he was, but he's somebody that we should all try to emulate. There's no doubt He's the greatest Jew that ever lived in our history in the way that he helped people. Let's all learn from him. Thank you very much. Thank you, Jim. And now I'd like to call upon Mr. Marcos Zalta, who is kind enough to share with us some of his personal experiences with Mr. Edmund Safra. Marcos.
Edmund Safra will always be a legendary figure, a legendary Jew, a legendary banker, a legendary philanthropist. However, having had the privilege and honor to work closely at his side for over 5 years, I choose to speak of him now not as a legend, but as a man. Mr. Safra was my boss, my hero, my friend, and as for many other people, a father figure. He taught me many things, not only about business, but more importantly, he took the time to teach me about life. Mr. Safra taught me that to be a great man, one had to accept the imperfections of others around you. He never lost patience with anyone, and when I would, he would remind me that if you want to be a big cup, you better learn how to be big and strong enough to carry within you all the little cups around you. Mr. Safra had so much respect for others that he never told anybody that they were wrong about anything. What he would do instead is ask me if I was sure of my answer. Somehow he was always right. Hashem blessed him with the most remarkable intuition. And the longer that I worked with him, the more I came to trust his intuition about people and things completely. After a short time, when he would ask me if I was sure about an answer, I would just smile and go back and think about where I went wrong. Mr. Safra honored his father and mother to a degree that I am sure no other son in history did. He was constantly dedicating new synagogues and yeshivot in their honor. He had a large painting of his father next to his desk in every office around the world. People would say that he did so because he would speak to it in search of his father's guidance. I believe that he kept the portraits there because the driving force behind his success in banking was to glorify the Safra name and make his father proud of him. The loss of his mother at age 12 was a tremendous blow to Mr. Safra, one I don't think he ever got over. He told me many times that his mother was a great inspiration for his charitable deeds. He told me how she would go around Beirut and send poor Jewish families to her home to ask her husband Jacob for help. Mr. Safra taught me that compassion has to be more than a word or an emotion. It had to be accompanied by action. I remember one year just before Pesach, he awoke me at 1 o'clock in the morning. He had found a fax in my office from a woman who was begging for money for many poor families. He made me come over immediately and would not go to sleep until I assured him that every one of those families would have enough food for Pesach. Mr. Safra cared deeply about people. He never thought of himself as better or worse than anyone else, and his compassion for others reflected this conviction. He had many, many housekeepers, but when one of them fell ill and needed an emergency heart surgery, he accompanied her to the hospital and spent the entire day there so that he could see her when she awoke because her family was far away in Brazil. She told me afterwards that seeing Mr. Safra with his famously warm and beautiful smile was the only thing that gave her the strength to survive that ordeal. When he was approached by beggars on the street and insisted against my objections on giving something always to them, he explained to me that it didn't matter what these people were about. You had to have compassion for whatever the circumstances were that brought them to beg on the street. Mr. Safra loved to talk to everyone, whether they be salesmen in stores, waiters in restaurants, chairmen of major corporations, presidents, or kings. He loved people, and people loved him back. Although he was an immensely powerful figure, he had an innocence and childlike quality that endeared him to everyone. How often did we meet people who had never met him before, and when he stepped out of the room, they would say, "How lucky you are to work for such a wonderful and sweet man." I was very lucky. Mr. Safra was a very, very humble man. He never accepted a thank you from the beneficiaries of his charity, whether it was building our Sephardic Community Center, paying for a child's education, or what many people don't know, paying millions of dollars to transport the thousands of Jews in Syria in 1992, when President Assad finally gave them freedom. Mr. Safra always said, "It is I who should thank you for the opportunity to help. You are the ones who did all the work." I believe that the best way that we can honor Mr. Safra is to try, each of us in whatever small way, to emulate him and live our lives as he did, with charity, chesed, and humility. What I realized while writing this speech is that although I will always miss Mr. Safra, who I loved very, very much, he will always be there within me, guiding me in the many lessons that I learned at his side. And I pray that all the members of our community will also learn from those lessons and live their lives as he did. Knowing Mr. Safra will always be the greatest honor of my life. I believe that he was put on earth to make it a much better place. He succeeded in doing so and made many of us better human beings as well. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mrs. Alter. Boys and girls, ladies and gentlemen, you should have the sheet of Tehillim, which you're going to call upon Rabbi Zarif to lead us in, please. What I'd like you to do is to as you say the Tehillim, Rabbi Zarif will say the Pasuk, a part of the Pasuk, and you repeat it after him in a traditional way. But I'd like you also to pay attention to the words. These prakim were chosen carefully. The first paddock on top of the sheet talks about the qualities of a human being. And undoubtedly, from what you've heard, you can see that Mr. Safra fits these qualities that David HaMelech is talking about. Mi yagur b'holecha, who will dwell in the house of Hashem, holech tamim ufo'el tzedek, person who walks and does justice and righteousness, v'dover emet bilvavo, and speaks only the truth. Lo asa l'reihu ra'ah, certainly never does any evil and only does good. O Seila lo imot le'olam, the pedic ends, person of this quality will never be forgotten, never be lost. And the second pedic undoubtedly is a statement of faith in Hashem, emunah, Hashem ro'i lo echsar. I will need nothing because Hashem will give it to me. And Hashem will always lead me in a righteous way. Gam ki'ereth b'geis salmavet lo'i ra'a. Even when difficult things may occur, I will not fear it because Hashem will protect me. Ki atah imadi. These undoubtedly the guideposts that guided Mr. Safra through his life. Please remain seated, but recite the Tehillim carefully with proper kavanah following Rabbi Zarif.
Mizmor eli David. Adonai mi yagur be'eholicha. Mi ishkon behar kochecha holech tamim hufo'el tzedek v'dober emet bilbavo lo ragel al lishono lo asa li ri'ehu ra بحرفه لو نسى على قربه نبزي بعين ابن مقاس بقيت يرقي أدوناي خبيد نشبع لها راع ولو يمير كسبو لو نتان بني شيخ بشو حد على المقيل لقاح عوسي إلي لو يموت لعلم مزمور لدافيد أدوناي روعي لو إخسر بنقوت ديشي يربي صيني علمي من وحوتنا هليني نفسي يا شباب ينحيني بمعجل صديق لما عنشمو جامكي إليخ بغيصل مافيت لو إرارة كي أتعمدي شبطيخة ومش عنتيخة هما ينحموني طاع روح لفناي شو الحال نيغيت صوري راي دشانتا بشي من روشي كوسي ربايا اخطب بحسد يردفوني كل يمي حياي بشبتي ببيت أدوناي لأوريخ يميم
Boys and girls, I'm asking now to please stand up, please rise. Ladies and gentlemen, please rise. Call upon Rabbi Shimon Cohen from our faculty to recite the Hashkafah. Please stand still, put the sheets down in your chair. Boys and girls, at least, okay? Shh. Recite the Hashkafah, listen carefully, and then answer to the Kaddish. And then remain standing until you're told to be seated, and we will close with the singing of everybody singing Hatikvah.
והחוכמה מאין תימסה, וזה מקום בינה. אשרי אדם מסע חוכמה, ואדם מפיק תבונה. מה רב טובך ששמפת לרעך, פעלת לחוסן בך, לגד בני אדם. מה יקר חסדך אלוהים, ובני אדם בעשה כנביך יחסיון, ירביון מדשן ביתך, ונחל עדניך תשקם. טוב שם משמן טוב, יום המעבד יום מבלדו, סוף דבר הכל נשמע, את האלוהים ירא ואת משרותיו שמור, כי זה כל האדם, יעלה זו חסיני וכבוד, עירנו המשכבותם, מנוחה נכונה, בשיבה העליונה, תחת כנפי שכינה, במעלת קדושים וטהורים, כזוהר הרקיע, מאירים ומזהירים, בחילוס עסמים, בכפרת אשמים, ברחקת פשע והקרבת ישע. וחמלה וחנינה לפני שוכן מעונה וחלקת הבא לחיי העולם הבא שם תהי מנת ומחיסת משיבת נפש השם הטוב לעילו נשמת רפאל אדמון עזרא ספרא בן אסתר רוח אדוני תניחנו בגן עדן ותפטר מן עמי הדין כראות אלה המראה שמאיה ברעה המלך ברחמיו יחוז ויחמול עליו וילווה אליו השלום ועל משכבו יהיה שלום כדכתיב יבוא שלום ינוחו על משכבותם הולך נכוחו הוא וכרוב ניסה שובימו בכלל הלך מסליחות וכן עשו ונאמר אמן. רבי חנן מהקשה אומר, השר הקדוש ברוך הוא לזכות ישראל, לפי חי ולהם תורה מסבור, שנאמר, אלוני חפש מעסיקו, יחדיר תורה ויחדיר, יתגדל ויתקדש שמי רבה, בעלמה דיברה חירותי, וימליך מלכותי, וישמח בוקנה, ויקרב משיחי, בחיי חול וביומי חול ובחיי רחוב בישראל בעגלה ובזמן קריב אמרו אמן. יהי שמי רבה מברך לעלם ולעלמי עלמיה יתברך וישתבח ויתפאר ויתרומם ויתנשא ויתהדר ויתעלה ויתהלל שמי לקודשה וריחו לעילה מכל ברכתה, שירתה, תושבחתה ונחמתה, דאמינם בעלמא ואמרו אמן. על ישראל ועל רבנן ועל תלמידי הון ועל כל תלמידי הון, דעסקין באורת הקדישתא, דבאתרא הדין ודבכל אתר ואתר, יהלנה ולהון ולחון, חינא וחסדא ורחמי, מן קודם מראה שמעיה, בארעה ואמרו אמן. יהי שלום הרבה משמיה, חיים וסבח, וישועה ונחמה, ושזבה ורפואה, וכולה סליחה וכפרה. ברב ובסלם לנו כל עמו ישראל, אמרו אמן. עושה שלום במרומיו וברחמיו, יעשה שלום לנו כעמו ישראל, אמרו אמן.
Please remain standing. Boys and girls, we at our usual assembly progress, of course, we sing both the Star Spangled Banner and Hatikva. Today, a special occasion. Mr. Safra had a very special and close relationship with the State of Israel and a love for the State of Israel. He did so much to develop the land and build up the land. As you heard in the opening remarks, a letter from Prime Minister Ehud Barak, we're going to conclude this part of the program, at least, with singing of Hatikva. Everybody, please join in with my young friend, Mr. Benjamin Crane from the fourth grade. Be seated. Boys and girls, that concludes the formal part of our program. You heard a great deal. Very difficult, impossible to summarize any human being in 45 minutes of words, especially a human being as multifaceted and as talented and as great and as left such an impact in the world as Mr. Safra. You heard today a couple of things I'd just like to summarize for us. One of the things that we can learn from Mr. Safra's life for ourselves. Mr. Safra, of course, on the surface, you look at him as a very wealthy man. He gave a lot of tzedakah. That certainly is very true. which have to scratch the surface. Most of us, perhaps all of us, will not be as wealthy as Mr. Safra was. But it's not the wealth that guides us from his life. I heard a number of things from speakers who knew him, a number of things I know about him that we can certainly implement in our lives. Number one, he had a great deal of dedicates and respect and courtesy for all people. He was a Mokir Rabbanan, respected, highly respected Talmidei Chachamim. At the same time, he was concerned about the common man, every single human being. You heard the statement, he would greet everybody with dedicates, whether he was the chairman of a multinational corporation or simply the doorman who opened the door in the hotel. You also heard about pride in his heritage. He had a great deal of pride in the centuries-old Sephardic heritage, in the Torah, and the Sephardic heritage that accompanied it. And he made many, many efforts, very successful efforts, to preserve that heritage onto the next generation. That becomes your job. As you grow up and you become heads of families, leaders in the community, you have that obligation as well. You also heard his stress on education. If there is a future for our people as a whole, if there's a future for the Sephardic heritage, it is through education of children, of young adults. We live in a complex world. It's only through education that you can begin to understand it and to be successful in it. You know that he lived a very private life. You didn't read about him in the newspapers all the years he was alive. He didn't make it on TV. He could have, I suppose, if he wanted to. But he was not that kind of a person. He understood what the Navi says, Hatznei Alechet, walk modestly with Hashem, walk quietly, be kind to others, help people. It was not, the big English word is ostentatious, not on display, certainly did not display his wealth. And lastly, perhaps most important, he had, God blessed him with a lot of talent, and God blessed him with the character to use that talent for good things, and his efforts were successful, very successful. That perhaps is a tremendous lesson for us. Each and every one of us, the youngest to the oldest, has unique talent and unique ability. We all have abilities to do things. It's our responsibility to learn from Mr. Safra, to use those talents, use those abilities to help others, as he did. He could provide jobs for dozens, perhaps hundreds, and perhaps even more, ultimately through all his projects, thousands of people. We may not be in a position to do that, but we're in a position to help the next person. We're in a position to help the boy and girl sits next to us in class. We're in a position to help our neighbor. And as you grow older and become adults in the community, we're in the position to help others through the various institutions of the community, the shuls, the yeshivot, the kurcholim, etc. So learn that important lesson. Those two, hasnei alechet, walk modestly with Hashem, be grateful for his blessings, learn how to use his blessings in ways that accomplish and that help people, whatever talents we have. That concludes our program. I'll ask you boys and girls, to remain seated as the members of the dais leave, and then you will be dismissed back to your class. Thank you very much. Please remain seated quietly. Gentlemen.
Teddy Sarua will now lead us in Hatikva. The Talmud in the Nedarim teaches us that we receive the Torah in the wilderness. And we are told that we received it in the wilderness to remind us of the barrenness, that just like a person, we have two choices in life. We could be vain, or we could appear to be barren and be humble. Vanity, as we all know, is a feeling of self-praise. It's a feeling that one has achieved great things. Humility, on the other hand, is a feeling that one's potential has not yet been reached. We are here today to recognize an individual who understood this very well. He understood that his time on life, his life on earth, regardless of his accomplishments, his achievements, his wealth, was to be one in which he was to live his life with great humility. We are here today to remind you of Edmund Safra, of blessed memory, that this man was indeed so humble that we do not want that he should ever be forgotten, and not to recognize what he has done for our community and the deeds that he has done for all of Israel and for people of the world community as well. If one wanted to be vain, Mr. Safra certainly had the reason to be. He's, as we all know, he's been identified as one of the richest men in the world. And at age 67, he was about to sell his banking business to the biggest British banking company for $9.9 billion. He personally started a bank in 1966 with a single branch on Fifth Avenue and 40th Street. And at his death, this bank was the third largest in New York behind Citibank and Chase Bank. We can learn much from this man. Perhaps the thing that I remember while I was growing up, that I remember quite vividly, was when he sold the trade development bank of his, of Geneva, to the American Express Company. And the American Express Company believed that Mr. Safra had violated a pledge not to go into a similar business for a three-year period. And they maligned his name and they associated with all types of untruths. Using the legal system, Mr. Safra sued American Express, and there was a settlement of $8 million and a public apology. When you're a person a very a younger age, to recognize that a leading Jew of the world got one of the largest companies in the world to offer a public apology, it's an unbelievable thought in my mind, as it was. I also remember vividly that the $8 million was not to go, not a single penny was to go to him, but it was to go to charities of his choosing. And the charities that he chose and the charities that he continues to support are right here at home in our Magen David community. He was a true friend and benefactor of our community. And I want you to remember that the next time you walk in to the center, the Edmund Safra building, to ensure that you, the young people of our community, have a place to be, a place to meet other people of your community, and a place to recognize all that you are. Remember Edmund Safra. The next time you go to pray at Shari Tzion, remember that is the Jacob Safra building in memory of his father. The next time you set foot in Rabbi Aluf's shul, or the Lebanese congregation, or for that fact in any shul, remember that Edmund Safra contributed to all the synagogues of our community. Remember that the senior citizen housing on Kings Highway and East 4th Street was created with Safra funds. But most important, or as important, please remember, though his name does not appear on the outside of the building, but your program has a beautiful picture of Mr. Safra and community leaders laying the cornerstone. Don't ever forget that this building, our school, would never have been a reality if it were not for Edmund Safra. He provided the funds to make this school a reality. One of those of you who know your history, an earlier attempt to build a high school did not end in success, but rather failure. This building and Edmund Safra will always be part of this building. The greater community also was fortunate to know Edmund Safra. He contributed $1 million to the Jewish Heritage Museum of New York. He financed the chairs of Sephardic Studies at Yeshiva University, a chair in Latin American Studies at Harvard University, and a Banking Studies chair at the University of Pennsylvania Wharton School of Business. Edmund Safra also sat on the International Advisory Board of Harvard University. As a knowledge to you and to tell you what he expects of you. We learn in Mishle that the size of the cedar tree is measured by its shadow, a man by his humility. Edmund Safra, of blessed memory, was an exceptional man, a genius in our community and the world, and a very generous individual. However quiet and humble he was, his death indeed gives quite a big shadow, a sense of darkness among us all. I now would like to introduce Mr. Ken Carey. Mr. Carey was a very, Mr. Joe Carey was a very close friend of Mr. Safra. They vacationed together, but most important, Joe Carey learned from Edmund Safra. He learned what it is to give back to a community. And some of the many institutions that Mr. Safra began, Mr. Carey continues. Thank
you. Thank you very much. It was very kind of you to say those words. One of the things about Edmund was he believed there was no aristocrats in our community, that everybody was equal and everybody had the same chance, and to help everybody that he could. If you'll bear with me, I'll read parts of my speech that I made yesterday at Shaar Tzion, where we had a magnificent memorial for Edmund. Edmund Safra was a very special person who I've had the privilege and honor of knowing for the past 31 years. To say that he was a brilliant and extraordinary businessman is a given which the whole world would agree to. However, there was more, much more to this great man. He was a great family man who loved, cherished, and treated his wife and his brothers as though they were the most important people in the world. He loved his communities the world over and supported them for yeshivot, synagogues, kollels, mikvahs, and you name it. I can't remember him ever saying no to help any Jew, no matter what the circumstances were. Because of his outstanding success, he gave dignity to the Sephardim that was always denied us until our Edmund came along. On numerous occasions, he asked me about certain people and how they were doing and if they needed help. He cared for every member of our community the world over. A kinder, gentler, more humble man did not exist on this earth. He was truly an angel. We as a community not only grieve for him and his family, we must learn from him. Be humble. Be caring. Help your fellow community members in their time of need. Give jobs to those who need them, not just a handout. And let me digress a little to say that when you all get older, and God willing, you'll be very successful, if somebody comes to you for help, if you're in the position to not only give them something to let them eat for the day or the week, but try to give them a job so they could earn for themselves. That was his quality. He gave thousands of jobs to our people whenever they needed them. Give tzedakah, respect the rabbinate, and most of all, and this was something that he harped on with me forever, was help educate our youth. We don't understand how he died. There are very many unanswered questions in that regard. But one of the last things that he did with me was tell me that we had an obligation to educate the Jewish children from our community worldwide. And he said, because of money, we can't let children go to public schools. And we were just setting up a foundation for that, which I have continued to do. I have opened up this past week the Edmund Safra Memorial Education Foundation, which will, God willing, help to educate all of the kids in our community. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Carey. During his lifetime, Mr. Safra managed to forge relationships with various individuals throughout the world. I would like to share with you a letter that was received from the Prime Minister of Israel. It is with great sorrow that we mourn the loss of Edmund Safra, an exemplary human being, a great philanthropist, and an ingenious businessman. On behalf of the government of Israel, I extend my sincere condolences to his wonderful family during this very difficult time. May they find a source of comfort in the knowledge that Edmund Safra led a rich and extraordinary life. He will be remembered by all of us for his kindness, compassion, and chesed. Sincerely, Ehud Barak, Prime Minister of the State of Israel. The video you're about to see was made during Mr. Safra's lifetime. We're presenting it to you today so that you can get a sense of the kind of individual that he was. Besides being a legend, he was also a warm and loving family man.
50 years ago, Edmund Safra set out on a journey to fulfill the prophecy of his father, to become a great banker. If you choose to sail upon the seas of banking, build your bank as you would your boat, with the strength to sail safely through any storm. These words, his family's commitment to the intense values of respect, prudence, conservatism, trust, loyalty, and charity instilled in him by his parents, have guided him through the years. Born in Beirut in 1932, Edmund Safra, the son of Esther and Jacob, who proclaimed early in his son's life that he would be a great banker. He began his education at his father's knee, preferring this way of learning to attending school, even after his father hired a valet to be certain his son arrived at school every day. His father's prophecy was fulfilled when at the age of 16, he left for Milan to begin his career. It wasn't long before Edmund's reputation was established as a prodigious precious metals and currency trader in Milan, Zurich, Amsterdam, and Geneva. Edmund's reputation earned no doubt by being always hard at work. By all accounts, his father Jacob was bursting with pride back in Beirut. In the early 1950s, believing that there were real opportunities to succeed in banking in Brazil, Edmund soon convinced his family to follow him there. By the mid-1950s, he and his family had built a successful trading, import, and finance company that ultimately became Banco Safra S.A., today the fifth largest bank in Brazil. Many long and arduous meetings involving difficult negotiations, all contributing to Edmund's formation as an experienced banker. In 1956, he left Brazil for Geneva, drawn by the challenge of building a Swiss private bank. During the many successful years he spent in Geneva, he founded his first fully chartered bank, the Trade Development Bank, and began to establish his reputation as one of the world's great private bankers. He followed his success in Geneva by pursuing his ambition to create a bank in the most important financial center in the world, New York City. Edmund formally opened Republic National Bank of New York on January 25, 1966. He engineered the tremendous growth of his banks over the ensuing years through innovative marketing, acquisitions, expanding into new geographical areas and lines of business. During these years of growth, Edmund and his family continuously adhered to his father's principles of prudence, trust, and of course, conservatism. Edmund has often been quoted as saying, "I am in no hurry to build my bank. I want to build a bank to last 1,000 years. The quality of his banks have been recognized around the world, and as confirmation of the banking community's belief in Edmund's objective of building a lasting bank, Safra Republic Holdings issued the first ever 1,000-year bond in October of 1997. Edmund Safra's commitment to charity is as serious as his commitment to banking. It's an obligation he feels he must fulfill, rooted in his childhood observation of his mother's distribution of food to those in need, sending the most needy to his father for money. He firmly believes that charity is an investment in people and the future. He founded the International Sephardic Education Foundation to help educate disadvantaged young Israelis. To date, the foundation has provided more than 10,000 university and postgraduate scholarships. Edmund has supported numerous synagogues, community centers, and other religious, cultural, medical, and educational institutions all around the world, always in honor and memory of his father and mother. His devotion to his father and mother is reflected today in his devotion to his family.
I am Joseph Safra, Edmund Safra, youngest brother. Effectively, I was brought up by you, Edmund. Since I left school, I was under your guidance, and practically every day you taught me another lesson. And whatever I achieved in my life, and whatever I am today, is only thanks to you. It's a very unique relationship between two brothers. And let me tell you, Edmond, that while you were watching me, I was also watching you,
but for different reasons. You wanted to make sure that I was doing well while I was watching you to copy you. You are for me my father, my dear brother, my teacher, and for that I have no word to show my gratitude to you. I want to thank you deep in my heart, and God bless you, and a big kiss to you. I am Moise Safra, and I am the brother of Edmond. When he was a young child, he was always very happy and jovial. He had many friends, and they would laugh together a lot. Many of his friends were older than he was. When he came back home, the house was much happier than when he was gone. We all laughed much more. My father was very proud about what he has done, and he spoke often about Edmond's success. Edmond was so successful that some of his competitors would spread it around that he was only 16 years old, and that because of his age, his commitments were not binding. This unfair competition did not stop him. Edmond, you are like a father to us, and we love you very much.
Edmond, congratulations on your 50th anniversary in the banking business from your 6,000 employees who have helped in their own ways to build this organization with you into the magnificent institution it is.
To my husband, who has given me so much, his devotion to our grandchildren, his presence at all times, not only for me and them, but for so many others, a father to his brothers and sisters, a loyal friend to so many throughout the world. Together, we've tried to keep our heads high, to fight for life and hope, to fight the battles in the name of justice. May our almost seven grandchildren achieve in their lives the values and ideals that you have taught them. You fulfill the essence of a human being. You are kind, decent, a man with no vanity, a humble man. Thank you, Edmond, for sharing these years with me.
It's important to understand that this very building that we're sitting in would never have been possible had it not been for the enormous generosity of Mr. Edmond Safra. He saw to it that we had access to all the resources that we needed in order to complete this magnificent yeshiva. The study of Torah that takes place here will certainly elevate his neshama. But now I'd like to turn it over to Rabbi Shimon Alu, Rosh Yeshiva.
Mr. Joseph Safra would like to add a few words.
Ladies and gentlemen, rabbis, I'm very happy to be here with you today. We have received the invitation, and I did not know exactly where I would be. This morning I was in the junior school, and I am here. I am very touched to see such a beautiful yeshiva, such a beautiful school, directed by extremely nice people, and I'm proud that my brother Edmo was one of the founders. As you saw in the film, what I told him, and I still promise you, Edmond, that we will do our best to continue your work and the work of our father who has taught all of us. Thank you very much.
Please be seated. כשעלה משה למרום לקבל את התורה, משה had very, very deep concern. Okay, Hashem, you give me the Torah. It's a wonderful gift to our people. But I'm worried not about my generation. I'm here today. I have full control. I have knowledge. I have students. I have people that are ready to learn from me. But how can you ensure me that this Torah will remain forever and will stay in the hearts and the mind of the Jewish people? And Hashem showed him by picture. Hashem ra'a le Moshe dor dor ve dor shav, dor dor ve hachamav. Hashem showed him to the end of the world, each generation with its own rabbis, with its own leaders, and told him, Moshe, you can be ensured that your Torah, Torat Moshe, will remain forever. Each generation named after its leader. Yesh doro shel Rabbi Shimon bar Yochai v'chaverav. Yesh doro, dor Hashema, doro shel Rabban Gamliel Hazaken. The door of the Tanaim and the Amoraim and Rabbanan Sevoraen, the Geonim. In each city, the generation, the era was named after the most important, influential man that gave the special color to that generation. You remember the era of Moshe Montefiore, Rothschild. Our generation, the generation that in Europe came out of the ashes, and in the Middle East, we were thrown out of our countries that we had communities established for hundreds of years, wealth that cannot even be comprehended by people. And we went out. We needed both. We needed spiritual leadership, which was gifted by Chachamim Gedolim, Baruch Hashem, in this our generation. And we had one person that just this generation would be named after him. It was Rafael Edmon Ezra Safra ben Esther Ruach Adonai Tenehenu b'Gan Eden. My memories with the Maroham Alav Shalom, and a personal note, just to tell you that I'm surrounded by Edmon Safra 24 hours a day. You know, my very important and the most important rabbi is a Gaon, Morenu v'Rabenu v'Ateret Roshenu, Arishon Lezion Chacham Avadia Yosef. When we moved to the new shul in King George Street, and Mr. I think Wolfson that time gave the, he built the shul, and they wanted from Edmond Alav Shalom a donation for the shul. He had one condition. I see my rabbi praying in his house. I want you to give a section to Chacham Avadia. And he called the shul Bet Yaakov. And I was there Hazan for 7 years with my Rabbi Chacham Avadia. I came to this country, and again I'm in Ahava Ve'Ahva, and I see the name of Edmond Safra Alav Shalom right away in front door. In the front door, Edmond Safra, I asked, what is the story? They said, we couldn't build the shul without Edmond Alav Shalom. He gave them a big loan, and in the time of the cornerstone, he is the one that took the key and put in the Megillah and took back the key with him, and he believed this key gave him a lot of luck. And he said, Ahava Ve'Ahva, I'm working 24 hours in Magen David. We know that we wouldn't be a school without Edmund. I live on Avenue S. So when I go home, Ocean Parkman Avenue S, on my right side is the center. You wouldn't have a place, our community wouldn't protect it from the outside influence without Edmund involvement, without building for us such a great place. I go one block, Avenue S, I see Bnei Yitzhak, and you see the cornerstone, Edmund Safra. Because the streets from the house, I open the window in the morning, you have Har Lebanon, Beit Yaakov. My house also, I took a mortgage from the Safra Bank, from a public bank. So the vision of this wonderful person, without him being personally involved in my life, he's involved in my life. This is a rabotai of a man that the generation named after him. And I remember when I was with my rabbi, and this way I'm going to introduce to you a very unique person. There was another name that always was identified with Edmund. It's our very dear friend, Mr. Miro Seton, Hashem Yishmero V'Chayehu. Frequently, he used to come and visit, and for sure, he had to hear from many Rashi Yeshivot, and we're not talking about small kolelim only, we're talking about big Yeshivot with need of a lot of money. And Miro was there with a checkbook, and he would sign. And I remember one day when he left the house, Chacham Vadia showed me the check, was with six numbers. It was for Porat Yosef, signed by Miro. Rabotai, you're going to hear from them, they knew him better than me. But there's no question that because of this great man that has the vision and the perspective, he wanted a bank that will last for 1,000 years. But here, this is the real investment that will last for many, many years to come. Because you're going to live tomorrow, and we're going to have other students in the school, and the school is growing, and the blood and the sweat and the strong belief at Edmund Safra is in the vein of the school. תהיה נשמתו הסלולה בסור החיים, ותעמוד נשמתו הטהורה בעד כל הקהל הקדוש הזה ובעד אחיו, אמן ואמן. בכבוד מאוד.
Thank you. Thank you, כבוד הרב, for the wonderful words you said. I take them on behalf of Edmond, not for myself. I was asked to speak to you about Edmond Alav Shalom. I guess your school has chosen me because I had the privilege to be very close to him and his family since my early childhood. As you heard, Mr. Safra was born in Lebanon, and his family lived less than a block away from my house in Beirut. We grew up together with Juju, with Moise, and the wonderful sisters, may she rest in peace, Evelyn, and Arlette, and Huguet, and Gabi. We were one big family. I remember his father receiving me like another brother. And they treated me like another brother, and I treated them like my brothers. May God bless them. As a child and a teenager, Edmond was a very active person. And I remember my father saying, "Mashallah, this kid is really a phenomenon. And no doubt, he will go very far in life." Indeed, he did. Short life. But that's a short. I could stand here for hours and talk about Edmond alayhi shalom. But I will try to describe to you as briefly as possible who he was, what he was, and what you and I should learn from him. Of course, we heard many distinguished speakers before me yesterday, before that in Geneva, at the funeral, we were there. And I want to stop a second and repeat what I said yesterday, which I mean, which I think each and every one should bear in mind, that we are as Jewish people. We were orphaned for thousands of years, and then we got back the state, and we are proud. As Sephardim, we were orphaned by the untimely death of our dear Edmond. But we also should act like other nations who have their leadership, their leaders to emulate and to live up to.
and we have the house of Safra. And the torch, I tell you, has been picked up by Moise and Edmond. These are our royalty. These are our leaders. Edmond was our crown, Nafla Ateret Roshenu. But as it's a formula to say, the king is dead, long live the kings. May God give you and your families long life, and may you go mihay el hay. Edmond alav shalom was an extremely intelligent individual, well above any man I encountered in my life. I worked for him close to 17 years at the Republic National Bank. And many a time, before I even, me or any other associate, started presenting an idea, he would have caught it and knew exactly where we wanted to go. This was some sort of a sixth sense. And that led him to build, together with his brothers, this financial empire stretching over the five continents of our planet. With all that, he was the most gentle person, humble to the extreme. And if I dare paraphrase the Torah, I would say, Ve'a'ish Edmon, anav mikola adam. He would remember everybody and give respect to everyone, be it the chairman of the major corporation or the doorman of a hotel. Above everything, he felt a limitless pride in being Jewish, Sephardi, and certainly of his Syrian-Lebanese origin. There is not a Jewish community anywhere that did not benefit from his generosity. You've heard that. I could stay here for hours. But there's other things, like old synagogues, landmarks that had to be restored, repaired. Be it Ashkenazi or Sephardi, didn't matter to him. He did it. Thanks to his generosity, one of our most revered shrines, Rabbi Meir Ba'al HaNes, you go there in Tiberias, and you will see this most beautiful mausoleum. It was before that, believe me, something not to be proud of. It was an eyesore. Hasve Shalom, that's what it was. And he couldn't take it. The community in Brazil, especially in Sao Paulo, came to life because of Edmond and his brothers, Moise and Joseph, here present with us. They subsidized kashrut, yeshivot, synagogues, youth center, you name it. They gave jobs, they employed, they helped the way he did here. He did it. They did it. He did it. Now we come back to New York. This very school has benefited from Mr. Safra's generosity since day one, as did every school and yeshiva in our community, both in Brooklyn and on the Jersey Shore. Our center, as mentioned many times, of which we are all so proud, received its biggest impetus from Mr. Safra on the day he dedicated to Sifrei Torah Sha'arei Tzion, which itself, Sha'arei Tzion, would not be this jewel of ours without his generosity. All you have to do, as we said, is to take a walk around our neighborhoods, and you will see the Safra name everywhere. Yeshivot, shuls, mikveot, you name it. However, and it was mentioned before, and I'll repeat it, at the cost of being repetitious, it doesn't matter, we should say. However, one of his most noble acts was to give job and security to any Lebanese who had to flee from the civil war and leave everything behind him. Whether they spoke English or not, whether they were qualified or not, his directive was, you give them a job. And let me tell you, for many of those, Baruch Hashem, that job was the stepping stone to careers in retail, wholesale, and today I know a good few who became not only self-supporting, but enjoying the American life and the American dream, as we call it. Talking about the war in Lebanon, he worked very closely with Alav HaShalom, Chacham Shachut Shreim, in order to evacuate all the Sifrei Torah, and other holy items, which was done at the cost of untold millions and with the minimum of damage. Now I want to conclude with something that should touch each and every one of you. As I told you before, Mr. Safra was very precocious, could not wait to join his father's bank. He therefore did not finish high school. But believe me, he confided in me many, many times about how much he regretted that. He encouraged his younger brothers, Moise and Joseph, to get that formal education, which they did in Brighton, England, at a Jewish college there. He was really obsessed with higher education. And finally, in 1977, he established the ISEF, International Sephardi Education Foundation, of which I was the first treasurer. Sonny Gindi was its first chairman. What Mr. Safra had in mind was primarily to provide college education to Sephardim in Israel, where he felt that they were lagging behind because of the lack of financial means. Today, 22 years later, close to 10,000 Sephardim in Israel have benefited from this scholarship, have graduated, and are becoming leaders in their own country. In conclusion, I think that what we could learn from Mr. Safra's life is to be a proud Jew, an observant Jew, a generous Jew, without neglecting to be an educated Jew. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Safra. And now I'd like to call upon Marco Zolta, who's kind enough to share with you some of his personal experiences with Mr. Edmund Safra, Alav HaShalom.
Edmund Safra will always be a legendary figure, a legendary Jew, a legendary banker, a legendary philanthropist. However, having had the privilege and honor to work closely at his side for over 5 years, I will speak of him now not as a legend, but as a man. Mr. Safra was my boss, my mentor, my friend, and as for many other people, a father figure. He taught me many things, not only about business, but more importantly, he took the time to teach me about life. Mr. Safra taught me that to be a great man, one had to accept the imperfections of others around you. He never lost patience with anyone, and when I would, he would remind me that if you want to be a big cup, you better learn how to be big and strong enough to carry within you all the little cups around you. Mr. Safra had so much respect for others that he never told them they were wrong about anything. He wouldn't use those words. What he would do instead is ask me if I was sure of my answer. Somehow he was always right. Hashem blessed him with the most remarkable intuition, and the longer that I worked for him, the more I came to trust his intuition about people and things completely. After a short time, when he would ask if I was sure about an answer, I would just smile and go back and think about where I went wrong. Mr. Safra honored his father and mother to a degree that I am sure no other son in history did. He was constantly dedicating new synagogues and yeshivot in their honor. He had a large portrait next to his desk in every office around the world. I believe that he kept the portraits there because the driving force behind his success in banking was to glorify the Safra name and make his father proud of him. The loss of his mother at age 12 was a tremendous blow to Mr. Safra, one I don't think he ever completely got over. He told me many times that his mother was a great inspiration for his charitable deeds. He told me how she would go around Beirut and send poor Jewish families to her home to ask her husband Jacob for help. Mr. Safra taught me that compassion has to be more than a word or an emotion. It had to be accompanied by action. I remember one year, just before Pesach, he awoke me at 1 in the morning in a panic. Apparently unable to sleep, he stepped into the office that I had at his home and found a letter from someone on my fax machine. "Come here, it's urgent," he insisted. It was a letter from a woman who was raising money for a number of very poor families. He would not go to sleep until I called him later and assured him that each of those families would have enough food for Pesach. Mr. Safra cared deeply about people. He never thought of himself as better or worse than anyone else, and his compassion for others reflected this conviction. When one of many of his housekeepers fell ill and needed emergency heart surgery, he accompanied her to the hospital and spent the entire day there so that he could see her when she awoke, because her family was far away in Brazil. She told me afterwards that seeing Mr. Safra with his famously beautiful and warm smile was the only thing that gave her the strength to survive that ordeal. When he was approached by beggars on the street and insisted against my objection on giving something to them always, he explained to me that it didn't matter what brought them to that point. One must have compassion for whatever the circumstances that led them to having to beg on the street. Mr. Safra loved to talk to everyone, whether they be salesmen in stores, waiters in restaurants, chairmen of major corporations, presidents, or kings. He loved people, and people loved him back. Mr. Safra was an extremely humble man. You've heard people describe him today as an aristocrat, as royalty, and as a king. While we may have viewed him that way, I can assure you that that's not the way Mr. Safra viewed himself. He viewed himself as just like every one of us. And his friends, he counted among them, his butlers, his assistants, his employees, kings, and presidents. He did not pursue a formal education, as you know, but he believed that in today's world, we have to pursue an education. You heard about ISEF. I believe that the best way that we can honor Mr. Safra is to try, each of us in our small ways, to emulate him and live our lives as he did, with charity, chesed, and humility. Although he was an extremely brilliant man, if you want to make him proud, go on to pursue an education, because it wasn't just his brilliance that contributed to his success. He worked just as hard, many times 14 to 16 hours a day, 7 days a week. Even when he was sitting at the pool at the insistence of his wife, he would spend the whole day on the telephone. He would say to me often, "You don't get lucky sitting at the beach. You get lucky sitting at your desk." What I realized while writing this speech is, though I will always miss Mr. Safra, who I loved very, very much, he will always be there within me, guiding me in the many lessons that I learned at his side. Knowing Mr. Safra will always be the greatest honor of my life. I believe that he was put on earth to make it a much better place. He succeeded in doing so, and in the process, made many of us better human beings as well. Thank you.
Ashkaban, please raise up. והחוכמה מעיית מעשה וזו מקומבינה אשרי אדם עשה חוכמה ודפק לבונה מה רב טובך שספנת לרעך פעלת לחוסים בך נגד בני אדם מה יקר חסדך אלוהים ובני אדם ישראל כנפיך יחסיון ירוויון מדשן ביתך ונחל עדניך תשכם ונחך אדוני תמיד והשביע בסחסחות נפשך ועצמותיך יחליז והיית כרבה וכמו סמיים אשר לא יכזבו ממב אז יבקע כשחר אורך וארוחתך מלא תשמח והלך לפניך צדקך כבוד אדוני יאספך טוב שם שם טוב ובמוות מיום היוולדו סוף דבר הכל נשמע את האלוהים ירא ואת מצוותיו שמור כי זה כל האדם
מנוחה נכונה בישיבה עליונה תחת קפה השכינה במעלה הקדושים והטהורים כזוהר הקאמרי ומזהירים וחילוס עסמים וחפרת אשמים והרחקת פשע והקרבת ישע וחמלה וחנינה מלפני סור שוכן מעונה וחולקת אבל לחיי העולם הבא שם תמינת ושם תפש הנדיב הגביר המפורסם מחזיק ביד התורה ולומדיה מרבה פעלים לתורה טוב הנפש אצל הרוח הענב דורש טוב לעמו השם הטוב רפאל אדמון עזרא בן אסתר רוח אדוני תנחנו בגן עדן דית פטר מן על מהדן כרעות אלה מראה שמיה והרעה המלך ברחמיו יחוז ויחמול עליו וילווה אליו השלום ועם משכבו יהיה שלום כדכתיב יבוא שלום מנוחה משכיבותם הולך נכוחו הוא מכל בן עשר השוך ועמו בכלל הרחמים והסליחות וכן יהיה רצון ונאמר אמן רבי חנניה בן הקשיא אומר רצה הקדוש ברוך הוא לזכות את ישראל לפיכך הרבה להם תורה ומצוות שנאמר אדוני חפץ למען צדקו יגדיל תורה ויאדיר
יתגדל ויתקדש שמי רבה ועלמא דיברה קרותי ומליך מלכותי וישמח פורקני וקרב משחי בחיי חול ומכון ובחיי לכל בית ישראל בעגלה ובזמן קריב ומנו אמן תהי שמי רבה מברך לעולם ולעלמי עלמיה יתברך וישתבח ויתפאר ויתרובם ויתנסה ויתדר ויתעלה ויתעלל שמי דקודשה וריחו לאלה מכל ברכתה שירתת שבחתה ונחמתה דמרם ועלמה ומנו אמן על ישראל ועל רבנם ועל תלמידי הום ועל כל תלמידי תלמידי הום תיעשתים בעולתה קדשתה די באתר הדר ודי בכל אתר ואתר יהלן אבולהון וכלנון חנה וחסדי רחמי מקדם מרש מיה והרעה ומרו אמן יהי שלמה רבה משמיה חיים וסבח ושואה ונחמה ושזבה ורפואה וגדולה וסלחה וכפרה ורבח ויסלה לנו כל עמו ישראל ומרו אמן ועושה שלום ברומה וברחמה ויעשה שלום עלינו ועל כל עמו ישראל ומרו אמן
Ladies and gentlemen, please sit down for a moment. We are deeply honored and touched that Mr. Edmund Safra's brothers joined us today, Joseph and Maurice. His brother Joseph told us and pledged that he was going to continue the work of his brother. But the work is not Mr. Safra's alone. And I think that's what the message that you heard through each of the speakers. The job to continue Mr. Edmund Safra, Blessed Memory's work, is within each of us. We each have a responsibility. Mr. Safra gave us so much, and perhaps we may not even have known what he gave us. He gave us a building, he gave us an education. We met someone this morning who was mentored by Mr. Safra, and he gave us his vision for each of you. And that is an education that you can grow and that you can follow, and the word that was used was emulate in the footsteps of Mr. Safra, and continue to build this community so that this community continue to grow to even greater strengths than it is today. So that each of us may be wearing a little bit of the crown of royalty of Mr. Edmund Safra. At this time, I'd like each of us to stand. Please stand. We're going to allow our guests to leave first, and then after our guests leave, the students in the outdoor atrium will go to their classes, and then in the Beit Midrash next. Thank you very much.